Unreal Motion Graphics is a visual UI creation tool which can be used to create UI elements such as in-game HUDs, in-editor tool widgets, or other interface-related graphics. At the core of UMG are widgets. These are pre-made functions that can be used to construct interfaces fast and include things like buttons, checkboxes, and sliders. These widgets can be edited in a specialized widget blueprint, which is made up of two main components: the Designer tool, which lets you create and alter the visual layout of the widget's contents, and the Blueprint Graph tool, which lets you bind logic to those widgets, such as changing the color of a button when the user presses it. To create a new UMG widget blueprint, right-click in the content browser, select User Interface, then select Widget Blueprint, and choose the User Widget class as the base. Then give it a name, such as bp_ui_demo. Now double-click this widget blueprint to open it in the Widget Blueprint editor. By default, this opens up the Designer tool. You can use these buttons on the right of your editor to toggle between this and the Blueprint Graph. By default, the Designer tool will have this layout, which places the palette over here on the left. This window contains the list of widgets that you can drag into the Visual Designer window or widget hierarchy to include in your interface. In this palette, search for Canvas Panel and drag this into the Visual Designer graph. We'll set the screen size displayed to be the 27-inch monitor, as that is what we're using to demo this. Then we'll bring our entire canvas into view by pressing the Zoom to Fit button. This canvas allows other widgets to be laid out anywhere within it, with anchors, Z orderings, and custom layouts, as well as enabling these widgets to have their own nested widget. To demonstrate this, search for vertical box in the palette window and drag it into the canvas. Then with this vertical box selected, press the anchors dropdown in the details panel. This contains a set of commonly used anchor presets, allowing you to anchor your widget to a specific part of its parent widget, in our case, the canvas. If we select the center anchor, you can see that the anchor gizmo has moved to show us our anchor's new location. If we reset our position to the center, you can see that our vertical box is slightly offset from the center. This is because our widget's alignment is pivoted at 0,0, which can be interpreted as the bottom right. These values should be set between 0,0 and 1,1, which would be interpreted as the top left. As we want our vertical box to be centered at the origin, we'll set this alignment to 0.5 and 0.5. Let's add some buttons to this vertical box by searching for button in the palette window and dragging two of these onto the vertical box widget in the hierarchy. As you can see, we have a slight problem here. Our buttons are exceeding the bounds of our vertical box. We can fix this in one of two ways. We either change our button sizes to fill the space given to them by their parent widget, in our case, this being the vertical box, or we can set our vertical box to resize itself to its contents, which will let the size of our buttons dictate the total size of the vertical box. In our case, we use the former, setting our button sizes to fill the space assigned to them by our vertical box. We'll also resize our vertical box to 400 in the X and 400 in the Y. This way, we can clearly see what's going on. We'll then set both of our buttons to have 5 pixels of padding in all directions. This way, they're not directly touching each other or the borders of the vertical box. We could also change our buttons' colors and define how they react to player interactions by altering their style in the details panel. We'll set the top button to have a red background and the bottom to have a blue background. Let's also give our buttons more representative variable names, such as button_top and button_bottom. Now, we'll switch over to our widget blueprint's event graph. As you can see, this tool looks a lot like the regular blueprint graphs, with our widget's variables, such as our buttons, being displayed in the variable section. Notice how our canvas and vertical box aren't being displayed here. If you want to change that, we would enable the isVariable checkboxes by their variable name in the details panel of the Designer tool. If we select our top button variable, we can see some useful overwritable events, such as onClicked or onHovered. Let's press the green plus button next to the onClicked event. This has created an onClicked event node, which will get called when the player presses this button. Let's get a reference to our top button variable by dragging it into the blueprint graph. We'll then drag off it and search for background color. We'll cache this color in a local linear color variable, which we'll name button top background color cache. And we'll do this as soon as our widget is constructed. Then in our onClicked event, we'll set the color of our top button to be green. Then we'll add a 2-second delay node and then reset its color to be the one in our cache. For demonstration, we'll now use the third-person template character blueprint to spawn and kill this widget. In our blueprint graph, we'll add an event node that will get triggered when our player presses the one key on the keyboard, then drag off this node and search for the create widget node. Then under class, we'll select our custom UI demo widget blueprint. We'll also add a private variable named umg_demo_widget_cache and set its type to be that of our demo widget. We'll then set the value of this variable to be the demo widget we just created. Next, we need to add an add to viewport node, which will add our widget to our game's viewport, filling up the entire screen by default. If we wanted this to only fill up some of our viewport, we would explicitly need to set the size which we want this to have. Now if we press play in our level editor, and then press 1, we can see that our UI has been created. However, you'll notice that we can't currently interact with it. This is because we need to set our player's input mode to game and UI, passing in our player's controller as a parameter. And finally, as we want our mouse to be visible, we need to set the show mouse cursor variable to true, again passing in our player controller as a parameter. Now if you press play, hit the 1 key, and press the top button, you can see that it changes to green for 3 seconds before going back to its cache red color. Let's now bind the event of the user pressing the 2 key to remove our widget from the viewport. Now if we press the play button and then press the 1 key, you can see our UI shows up. Then if we press the 2 key, it disappears. Another way to set this up would be through event binding, but that's out of the scope of this video. So far, we've barely scratched the surface of what you can do with UMG. Subscribe to be notified when we release our tutorial series on how to recreate the entire Overwatch 2 user interface, including transitions and effects using the system and all of its tools. Don't forget to like the video. We've been your game dev pals. If you found this video useful, consider checking out our Patreon. Tell somebody you love them, and we'll see you in the next one.